Good evening, everyone, and thank you for being here. I have been asked to speak about my life in some sort of a continuum, linking the past to the present and to the future. Now, consciously or unconsciously, the biggest influence on my selfhood and my identity has been my disability. And when I use the word disability, I must qualify that I am not referring to the polio on my left leg, and neither am I referring to the way that I walk. But I use the term in a political way to reveal how society and culture perceive my bodily condition and tacitly participate in the social construction of disability. I'm referring to disability as social oppression, to the fact that the lives of the disabled anywhere in the world entail a struggle for choice, for empowerment, for participation, for their rights, and for social justice. Now, definitions are important in the beginning because social policies are framed on the basis of these and they determine the action to be taken. For instance, if you look at disability as a personal tragedy, then you will look at disabled people as victims of tragic circumstances, and social policies will aim at compensating the victims. But if you look at disability as social oppression, then you will look at disabled people as collective victims of an uncaring society. And so social policies will aim at removing the oppression and enabling agency. Thus, definitions influence who people think or feel they are or ever can be. The WHO says that the disabled people are the world's largest minority, and this figure is ever increasing with medical advances, with the aging process, with population growth. If you were to go to Europe, in some European countries, about 33 bodily conditions are considered disabilities, but in India today, about 21 bodily conditions are considered disabilities. The point I'm trying to make is that definitions are fluid. They are shaped by different kinds of historical, cultural, social, and legal determinants and are often controversial. A few years ago, I met a bureaucrat, and I happened to ask her what programs her ministry took up for disabled women. So she looked at me quizzically at first and then unfazed said, "Arey bhai, let the ministry first work for normal women. When a certain threshold is reached, we will also consider disabled women." Now, what is the import of her response? It means that disabled women are not normal women. It means that the concerns of normal women merit greater attention, and only after their ends are served can disabled or other not so normal women get some attention. Third, a disabled woman like me would be considered naive if she raised such questions. And four, it means that disabled women are not part of the general category of women, but some kind of a subordinate group. And finally, it reeks of ableism in its patronizing tone, in its barely concealed rhetoric, in its assumed hierarchy of disabled versus non-disabled women. Now, I'm not saying that the bureaucrat was insensitive, just that she was completely clueless of her own ableist thinking. And what is normal? It's a very problematic term. Who is normal? What is normal? Who determines who or what is normal? Each time in my life that I was made to feel different or lesser than others, it came not from within but from without. And instances such as these abound in the lives of disabled people. Take name calling, for instance. In Gujarat, where I grew up, I often heard the terms kaniyo, which means one-eyed, langdo, which means one-legged, bobdo, which means someone who doesn't have a tongue, and grasshopper, titti ghodo, because we limp, lurch, sway, or hobble. Now, these never seemed to be simple terms that were, used just to name certain kinds of people, but they seemed to be pejorative, they were imbued with negative devaluations, and sometimes seemed to be cuss words that were hurled our way. As a child growing up, when I heard these terms, I felt like a criminal. Tainted, disgraced, it was as if I had been pushed off a high moral ground. And the non-disabled world, instinctually and without thinking, affixes these labels on us as being deviant and devious, pitiable or contemptible, and erases all other attributes we may have. And we, the disabled, internalize these terms through the socialization process and spend a large part of our lives perceiving ourselves through the eyes of others. We are made to feel small, we are made to feel flawed through the ubiquitous stare, through thoughtless remarks, and this colors our soul, the very core of our being. It becomes our lifetime memory, our identity. It does not help that in India since ancient times, stereotypical disabled characters have colored the popular imagination through mythology, literature, and cinema. And here, disability is considered to be something evil, something to be distrusted or feared. I was 12 when a teacher at school remarked, you know Manthara in the Ramayana, the hunchback? She was so cunning. She was responsible for all the tragedy that befell Lord Rama. Disabled people are not to be trusted. They are like menial servants. Yatha akriti, tatha prakriti. Form is determined by, your character is determined by your form. Now this was, your disability is a visual difference, but it is loaded with metaphoric and symbolic meanings. And it attributes a superior position to the non-disabled identity and thereby leads to unrealistic perspectives of disability. I was 8 when a classmate at school remarked, oh, my mummy was telling me that if you commit sins in this birth, you will be born blind, deaf or mute in your next birth. So your leg is the fruit of your karma. This age-old Hindu philosophy of karma colors everything we do. It tells us that whatever happens to us in this life is the result of our actions in an earlier life, and that any life at the margins, including disability, is determined by fate and hence hopeless. We grow up hearing, thankfully not always believing these things. I grew up reading how in the West, the Roman Empire conceptualized disabled people as monsters. And also how the eugenic principle of survival of the fittest directly led to Hitler's extermination of 3 million Jews in Nazi Germany, disabled people in Nazi Germany. So in a country where cinema is often called the opium of the masses, I grew up watching films which dehumanized disabled people by equating disability with defective minds and bodies, as a burden on society, with suffering, shame, and stigma. And these characters were people to be stared at. They were mere caricatures. They evoked pity or hostility by hobbling around on crutches, by crawling on the ground, and by being wheelchaired around. They never seemed to be realistic. They were rooted in the idea that disabled people deserve our pity, that they are passive, unproductive and powerless members of society who must adjust and accept their situation with courage, or that they are emotional, demanding, difficult, irrational, morally depraved, undersexed, oversexed, and have to be put up with. Growing up, I never saw a character with a disability in a film who had a disability, but went about his or her life like everyone else, who lived like the ordinary person next door, who queued up for a bus, went to college, dated, got married, had children, and lived happy, fulfilled lives in the most mundane ways possible, who just happened to have a disability. The whole belief that disabled people are unhappy and crave to be normal is also a form of social oppression. Now, this is an idea that is perpetuated by the medical fraternity, despite its good intentions to eliminate disability. And, because they believe that the problem lies in the disability, not, in the body, and the person is the problem. Here, the whole effort goes into care and cure, surgeries, which are done looking at aesthetic and medical standards so that the disabled person becomes whole again. Now, this kind of view of disability looks at it as an abnormality, as defective minds and bodies, as a departure from a valued standard, and it upholds able-bodied normalcy. Of course, that's the whole problem. And it tells me that disability is not a complex life experience. It stigmatizes me by telling me that my disability lies in my anatomical body. It does not allow me to enter able-bodied society except on the norms of the able-bodied minority. It upholds able-bodied normalcy and it tells me that I do not have the power to transform my life without the help of professional bodies. This cannot be far from the truth. Because we need more positive social identities. And how about an affirmation of our capabilities? I wore calipers which went up to my thigh till the age of 15. They were heavy, they were cumbersome, they were ugly, and I always used to wonder how anyone could think that someone would want to use them or be seen wearing them. To me, they seemed to be a marker of my disability and to be sending out signals of pity. Now, it's ironical because disabled people need these aids and appliances, but they heap stereotypes on them and negatively devalue the body. I spent 4 decades of my life looking for appropriate footwear that would be both functional and aesthetic, that would conform to feminist notions, you know, of beauty. And of course, I never found it. Finally, I had to wear sports shoes. Happily so, though. So the whole thing is the problem with mainstream design. You know, the problem with mainstream design is that it does not look at psychological and emotional factors in design and design products. It overlooks the lifestyle aspirations of disabled people and does not consider their potential as market potential as consumers. You know, it negates all of it. As a young girl growing up, I often, I realized very early on that the higher your mark on the normalcy meter, the greater your possibility of being desirable and desired, of finding a groom in the marriage market, of winning parental approval on an able-bodied union that would affix a seal on your future marital happiness. And then I found that I was nowhere in the reckoning. My self-concept hit rock bottom. But some of us are able to extricate ourselves from these kind of internalizations, perhaps because we have a supportive and loving family and community environment, a good education and financial means to ameliorate the physical experience of disability. My parents brought me up right. They just let me be. And so I grew up believing I could do anything. I could be anyone. And my disability ceased to be the overriding concern in my life. Later, my husband and then my daughter, who's sitting right here, urged me to stop trying to be superhuman and to realistically look at myself. So these different perspectives beautifully balance themselves out in my life. But not everyone is as fortunate as I am, because they may have enough negative experiences in their life to undercut any dignified passage through life. Then there is this whole narrative of overcoming your disability. It is so loathsome, where the disabled person is expected to be an example, an inspirer to both the disabled and the non-disabled world by demonstrating superhuman attributes. This is what is called the supercrip phenomenon, with hyper-masculinization and hyper-feminization thrown in for good measure. So growing up, I was also often, you know, because I excelled in academics and so on, I was also put up on a pedestal as an example to be emulated, and back then I would feel really happy. But today I wonder. The more you set yourself up as an example for others, the greater your acceptability quotient in the non-disabled world. You are made a lesser version of yourself by culture. With much perseverance, you can they allow you to be a greater version of yourself, but the irony is that you're never allowed to be yourself. 16 years ago, I was standing at a bus stop in disability, and now I'm going back to how disability is constructed. So all around me, I saw people in wheelchairs, you know, going around. And I was wondering whether there is a greater incidence of locomotor disability in that part of the world. Then suddenly the queue moved. A person using a wheelchair came to the head of the bus. The driver pressed a button and the bottom step rolled out. It was a hydraulic bus. The person expertly maneuvered her wheelchair inside because the passage inside was wide enough. Everyone sitting in the first row got up, folded their seats as we do in railway compartments. And that is when I realized why I saw people with disabilities everywhere in public spaces, there in restaurants, in banks, in malls, and why ever not in South Asia. So when is disability constructed by society? When society does not have usable public transport, an accessible built environment, a universal design code, when there are communication barriers, unrealistic expectations of the body, myths and fears about disability, and so on and so forth. Individual prejudice, institutional discrimination, very important. So 16 years ago, I decided that I would work in the area of disability. So today I do that, you know, education and employment empower, they give you voice. And that is what I have been doing. I've been writing about disability, I've been working in the area, I've been reading up, both from within academia and with disability collectives as a mode of expression, but also to resist. We need to listen to more life experiences of disability, not dismiss them as rants. We need to engage with able-bodied normalcy and question the idea that an able-bodied and mind determine a quality human being. And we need to also realize that able-bodied normalcy as a cultural construction itself is aligned with structures and hierarchies of power and privilege. Right. And that's all that I wanted to say here today. But this is what I wish to do through my work in the future. Thank you for patiently listening.